والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome to a new program, a new episode of Correct Your Citation. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Most Merciful. Praise be to Allah alone, we praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is the truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Dear viewers everywhere, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Also, I'd like to welcome our guests here at the studio. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In today's episode, inshallah, in the first segment, we'll deal with a few verses pertaining the beautiful story of Musa alayhi salam, his servant Yusha ibn Nun, and Al-Khadr, the person whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him a knowledge from him that Musa alayhi salam had no idea about it. And he decided to join him to learn from him. With verse number 60, eventually in the last episode, we learn the entire story from the hadith, which was narrated by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the entire story of Musa and Al-Khadr. We did not explain the interpretation of the incidents or the cases in which Musa alayhi salam did not understand why Al-Khadr was doing that. So we'll go with the verses in order to learn very important lessons, inshaAllah Azza wa Jal. Verse number 60. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. وإذ قال موسى لفتاه لا أبرح حتى حتى أبلغ مجمع البحرين أو أمضي حقبا. This is where the story begins. Musa عليه السلام said to his servant يوشع ابن نون, I will continue traveling and I will not give up traveling until I reach the junction of the two seas. Why is that? Because this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed for him the meeting with Al-Khadr. Peace be upon all of them. Or I spend years and years in traveling. That is the meaning of the word حُقُبَة. Some of the interpreters of the Qur'an said the حُقُبَة is 1 year. Some said 70 years. Some said lifetime. So that means Musa a.s. was so determined. No matter what happens, I will continue traveling until I achieve this goal. Which is what?
Meeting
of Khadr.
What is the purpose of meeting
to learn Khadr? From him.
Many of the students and the seekers of knowledge are dying to meet the big shuykh. And when they meet them, they say, I'm a big fan of you. I'll listen to you. He's not a singer. He's not an actor. You don't need an autograph from him. The purpose of meeting the shuykh is to learn from them. Or perhaps ask them to pray for you. That is the benefit. And that's why Musa alayhi salam, even though he was a prophet and a messenger, so in his rank he was superior to any other human. But he was so determined to join and to follow one of the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who had knowledge that Musa alayhi salam, yet he was a prophet, he did not have. Then they proceeded on whom? Musa alayhi salam and his servant Yusha ibn Nun. By the way, Yusha ibn Nun is the person who is entrusted with the prophethood to lead Bani Israel after the death of Prophet Moses, peace be upon him. So verse number 61, Allah the Almighty says,
فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَجْمَعَ بَيْنِهِمَا نَسِيَا حُوتَهُمَا فَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ سَرَبًا.
Basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed Musa alayhi salam that the meeting will be at the junction of the two seas, the salt and the fresh water. And there he gave him a sign that take a salted fish with you. If you ever lose a salted fish, this is a place where you're supposed to meet with Al-Khadr. But how would you lose a fish while it is dead? Not only that, it is salted and it is ready to be eaten. We said that they rested their back against a rock. They took a shelter there and they slept. As they slept, there was a water spring there, which is called Aynul Haya. If this water would have touched anything, it would bring it back to life. So eventually, the water, by the leave of Allah, of the spring, touched the salted fish. And it came back to life. It slipped into the sea, and it made its way like in a tunnel. So it's like engraving a groove in the rock, and that is the meaning of وَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ سَرَبَ. Compare the word سَرَبَ to the word عَجَبَ in the next verse. But when they reached the junction of the two seas, they forgot their fish. And this is what happened. And it took its way through the sea as in a tunnel. The water would not come back after the fish made its way. Rather, it would stay like it made its way into a rock or in a tunnel. Verse number 62. Allah the Almighty says,
فَلَمَّا جَاوَزَا قَالَ لِفَتَاهُ آتِنَا غَدَاءَنَا لَقَدْ لَقِينَا مِنْ سَفَرِنَا هَذَا نَصَبًا.
Says whom? Musa alayhi salam, as they traveled after they woke up, they took some break or a rest. Then they resumed traveling the rest of the day and a whole night. Then in the morning, Musa alayhi salam was hungry. They experienced fatigue and they were exhausted. So he said to his servant, Yusha ibn Nun, bring us the food. Which food?
The fish.
The fish. So, لَقَدْ لَقِينَا مِنْ سَفَرِنَا هَذَا نَصَبًا. Truly, we have suffered much fatigue in this our journey. And that shows you the suffering of a prophet in order to seek knowledge. Knowledge to achieve is not that easy. You have to make an effort. You have to spare time and you have to spend money in order to learn. Verse number 63. Now, Yusha ibn Nun will remember what happened to the fish. And will tell Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, that we lost it at the junction of the two seas.
قَالَ أَرَأَيْتَ إِذْ أَوَيْنَا إِلَى الصَّخْرَةِ فَإِنِّي نَسِيتُ الْحُوتَ وَمَا أَنْسَانِيهُ إِلَّا الشَّيْطَانُ وَمَا أَنْسَانِيهُ إِلَّا الشَّيْطَانُ أَنْ أَذْكُرَهُ وَاتَّخَذَ سَبِيلَهُ فِي الْبَحْرِ عَجَبًا.
In this verse, Allah the Almighty tells us what Yusha ibn Nun said to Musa alayhi salam. He said, do you remember when we betook ourselves to the rock, when we rested there? I indeed forgot the fish, even though it was both of them. Not only Yusha, but he attributed forgetfulness into himself. I indeed forgot the fish, and none made me to forget it but Satan, in order to mess up our meeting with Al-Khadr. Then it took its course into the sea in a strange way. In the verse before the last, who said that it took its way into the sea or in its course into the sea in a tunnel, like a tunnel. But here it is describing the amazement of Musa alayhi salam and his servant Yusha ibn Nun. How could a dead fish come back to life, then make its way into the water? Mm-hmm. Okay? Then it gets back to life again. What happened? Musa alayhi salam realized that this is the place we were supposed to meet with Al-Khadr. So what did he say? In verse number 64, he said,
قَالَ ذَٰلِكَ مَا كُنَّا نَبَغُ فَارْتَدَّ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمَا قَصَصًا.
In the first verse which we studied today, he said, no matter what happens, I will continue traveling, even if I travel for ages. But now he realized that it was only maybe a day and a night. So they retreated back, following their footsteps, the traces of their footsteps, until they reached back to the place where they have lost the fish. Eventually, as we quoted in the hadith last time, when they reached there, Musa alayhi salam found somebody who was covered with his cloth, and he approached him, he greeted him, and he introduced himself to him, and that happened to be Al-Khadr, peace be upon all of them. And this is what the next verse would tell us. Verse number 65.
فَوَجَدَا عَبَدًا مِّنْ عِبَادِنَا آتَيْنَاهُ رَحْمَةً مِّنْ عِنْدِنَا وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا.
So they both found one of our servants, unto whom we had bestowed mercy from us, and whom we had taught knowledge from us. Sometimes knowledge without mercy and humility leads to arrogance. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed us in one hadith that amongst the three people who would enter fire, the first, a alim, a scholar, a knowledgeable person who used to teach people knowledge, righteousness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would tell him that and remind him, I bestowed knowledge upon you. What did you do with it? He would say, I taught it to people for your sake. He said, you lied. You only did that in order to be said, what a scholar. And it was said, take him to fire. But this servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Khadr, was given what Muhammad? Mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him, which gave him humility. Then right away, Musa alayhi salam requested from him. And let's learn how to request from the scholar, seeking knowledge from him, or joining his halqa or his class in order to learn the etiquette of the seekers of knowledge or the manners of the seekers of knowledge with their shuyukh. قال له موسى هل أتبعك على أن تعلمني مما علمت رشدا. Look at that. Moses, peace be upon him, said to him, to Al-Khadr, may I follow you so that you teach me something of that knowledge which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have taught you? May I? Look at the request with etiquette, with gentleness. Even though Musa alayhi salam was superior to him because he was a prophet. But may I? And that teaches us that even if the person who happens to be the sheikh is way younger than you, you should pay him respect because he is an instructor, he is a sheikh, and you are the seeker of knowledge. Well, what did Al-Khadr say to Musa alayhi salam? Was he happy that a prophet would follow him, the prophet of his era would follow him to learn from him? What did he tell him? He said, قَالَ إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعِيَ صَبْرًا. He said, you will not be able to have patience with me. Over what? Over things that you would think it is strange and weird because you have no idea about it. And we said in the hadith that Al-Khadr said to Musa alayhi salam that, look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed knowledge upon me that you have no idea about it. And he bestowed knowledge upon you that I do not have any idea about it. You will not be able to have patience with me concerning learning this knowledge which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon me. Look and listen to the beautiful answer of Musa alayhi salam. But before, Al-Khidr continued to say, وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرُ عَلَى مَا لَمْ تُحِطْ بِهِ خُبَرًا. How is it possible that you can have patience about a thing which you have no idea about it? Musa alayhi salam confirmed his strength and his strong will of learning by saying, قال ستجدني إن شاء الله صابرا ولا أعصي لك أمرا. Moses said, if Allah will, listen carefully. In this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us earlier, if you remember the story of the cave, and when the Meccans came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inquiring about three questions. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, tomorrow I shall inform you about the answer. Then Jibreel alayhi wa sallam was delayed for 15 days. Then the surah was revealed with the answers, along with another verse of Surah Al-Isra. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a very important lesson, which to be taught to the entire ummah as well. When he said, وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهِ وَاذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ. Don't you say that I shall do that tomorrow, I shall go here or there, I shall fulfill this tomorrow, without saying inshaAllah, God willing, because nothing happens in this universe but according to his will. So that was a very important lesson. Here Musa alayhi salam, even though he was sure that he would like to join him, and he is very sincere in his intention of learning, and he will have patience. But he said, قال ستجدني إن شاء الله صابرا ولا أعصي لك أمرا. And this is a very beautiful way of confirming your statement, because you don't know whether maybe you're overestimating yourself, your ability. So it is best to say, إن شاء الله ستجدني إن شاء الله صابرا ولا أعصي لك أمرا. And another lesson, that with the Shaykh, whom you're learning from him, among the manners is atta'ah, the service of the Shaykh, or the tutor, or the learned person who's teaching you, and atta'ah, especially if he is a person who's instructing you to what's good for you in the life and in the hereafter as well. And obviously he was directed to Al-Khadr by whom? By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why he confirmed, وَلَنْ أَعْصِي لَكَ أَمْرًا ولا أعصي لك أمرا. And I will never disobey a command of yours. Okay. Now, look at the terms and the conditions of this companionship. قال فإن اتبعتني فلا تسألني عن شيء حتى أحدث لك منه ذكرا. Well, Al-Khadr is put in his conditions. He said, well, if you want to join me, then you follow me, ask me not about anything till I myself mention it to you. You should not ask me about the interpretation or the reasoning of any act that I do until I take the initiative and I tell you. And by the way, that was a very, very tough condition.
Yeah.
Because, you know, if we're listening to the story, reclining, maybe having a cup of tea and say, wow, it's nice, but Musa, be quiet, listen. Remember the condition. But if you were in his position, you would have forgotten so many times. We're talking about very amazing lessons that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Musa alayhi salam and eventually all of us on the hand of Al-Khadr, peace be upon all of them. Okay. In verse number 70, قَالَ فَإِنِ اتَّبَعْتَنِي فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِي فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِي عَنْ شَيْءٍ حَتَّى أحدث لك منه ذكرا. And in verse number 71, فانطلقا. Then they proceeded on, both of them. فانطلقا حتى إذا ركبا في السفينة خرقها. قال أخرقتها لتغرق أهلها لقد جئت شيئا إمرا. فانطلق. But guess what? يوشع بن نون also joined them. حتى إذا ركبا في السفينة. So they both proceeded till when they embarked the ship. We mentioned in the hadith that the crew of the boat recognized Al-Khadr, the kind man. So they offered him the ride for free. They did not charge him an art. Then Musa alayhi salam accordingly joined him for free. And this is very important to remember, that they've done both of them a favor. So we're supposed to return the favor by another favor, or at least by gratitude. Look what happened. So they embarked the ship or the boat. Musa alayhi salam witnessed a very amazing act was done by Al-Khadr. Al-Khadr pulled one of the planks of the ship and he made it faulty. He damaged the ship. So Musa alayhi salam said, this is so weird. These guys have offered us the ride for free, and instead of thanking them, you want to drown them. لَقَدِ جِئْتَ شَيْئًا إِمْرَى. And Imra, according to some of the Mufassirin, means ajaba. This is very weird. Why did he do that? According to others, this is an evil act. And in the future, we'll get to compare and have a contrast between the word Imra in verse number 71 and the word Nukra, which is coming in verse number 74. Well, قال ألم أقل إنك لن تستطيع معي صبرا. الخضر reminded موسى عليه السلام with the pre-agreement and the conditions which they have agreed to, that you should not ask me any questions or about the interpretation of anything unless and until I explain it to you. So he reminded him. In this verse, verse number 72, this reminder was soft. And that's why he said, in the grammar, he reduced the pronoun of you. He said, قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ إِنَّكَ. He said, didn't I tell you? And basically, if I want to translate it literally, I'm going to erase or delete the word you. And reducing this word or eliminating this word would make the reminder much milder than if I pour it. And in verse number 74, it will be added though. قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعْيَ صَبْرًا. Didn't I say that you will not have patience or you will not have the power of having patience with me over witnessing the things which I'm going to do without asking me about their interpretation? The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, this very first time from Musa alayhi salam was out of forgetfulness. He said, قَالَ لَا تُؤَاخِذْنِي بِمَا نَسِيتُ وَلَا تُرْهِقَنِي مِنْ أَمْرِي عُسْرًا. So Musa alayhi salam acknowledged the fact that he admitted it. And he said, I'm sorry, I forgot. I really forgot totally that I was not supposed to ask questions. In addition to, I did not know that this is one of the lessons that you're teaching me. Well, that was the very first lesson. And unfortunately, Musa alayhi salam forgot totally about the promise and the covenant which he made with Al-Khadr. We still have some more lessons, basically two of them, which inshallah will resume learning what happened with Musa and Al-Khadr, peace be upon them, inshallah, in the next episode. A short break and we'll be back. Please stay tuned. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Anyone who chooses other than Islam as a religion, as a way, it won't be accepted from him. This Quran has to be understood by the way the companions of Rasulullah understood the Quran. We disconnect ourselves from the actions of certain Muslims who oppress people and kill people unjustly.
Recite it every day.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Let me remind you with our phone numbers, because right after this segment, inshallah, we'll be happy to take your phone calls. Area code 002-0238-555-248 or 249, and I believe the numbers appear on the screen as well. If you remember, we said in the last time we will wrap up the rules of Al-Mudud, especially Al-Mad, Al-Lazim, or the compulsory Mad. Right, Chindi?
Yeah.
Okay. There is a very important step that we have to take before we depart Al-Mudud, then we move into a new set of rules, which is the different cases of the letters which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala began some of the chapters of the Quran with. When I looked at those letters, not only me, I mean the scholars before us, of course, they have found that there are 14 letters. 14 letters out of the 28 Arabic alphabet. And they put those letters in a phrase. Some phrased it differently, some phrased it in a phrase that would give a meaning, such as, they said, طَرَقَ سَمْعَكَ النَّصِيحَةُ. Basically, they mean that each one of those letters which phrase this sentence is one of the letters which some of the chapter of the Quran began with. Since the jumhur of the mufassirin, the vast majority of the interpreters of the Quran, specifically our predecessors and the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, paused with the meaning of those letters, such as Alif, Lam, Mim, Taha, Yasin, etc. They said those are letters from our Arabic alphabet, from our language. Yet only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows their meaning. It seemed like Allah was challenging the Arab, that those letters phrase words which Allah knows their meaning, and it is your language, and you do not encompass the meaning of those letters. So it was a challenge. Many of the mufassirin, especially of the later ones, tend to find explanations and link between numbers. And the best answer to all of that is that Allah knows best. Because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not say a specific meaning of, for instance, Alif Lam Mim, or Taha, or Yasin. You find people named their sons after Taha or Yasin, etc. Believing that these are the names of the Prophet ﷺ and he was addressing them. It was said by some of the interpreters of the Quran. But these are all ijtihadat, speculations. In fact, there is no strong reference that Taha was one of the names of the Prophet ﷺ, nor Yasin. So we're supposed to pause, as did our predecessors and the companions of Rasulullah ﷺ, who learned the Quran and its meanings from him directly, especially the Turjuman of the Quran, the great interpreter of the Quran,
Abdullah ibn Mas'ud.
No, Abdullah ibn Abbas. The son of Al-Abbas, the Prophet's uncle. So that's why some other scholars of the Tajweed and the Mufassirin as well rephrased the letters, the 14 letters, which they have found in the beginning of these surahs, and they put them in a beautiful phrase. Look at that. These letters combined in the Arabic phrase, نَصٌ حَكِيمٌ قَاطِعٌ لَهُ سِرٌ. And that makes a lot of sense. So it's not just a phrase. Rather, it's a phrase that gives an inspiration of the purpose of these letters, according to the view of the vast majority of the interpreters of the Quran. نَصٌ, this is a text. حَكِيمٌ, wise, قَاطِعٌ, precise, لَهُ سِرٌ, that has a secret. That's preserved with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and only those whom Allah has taught. نَصٌ حَكِيمٌ قَاطِعٌ لَهُ سِرٌ. So, I don't want you to keep yourself busy with the meaning. Rather, look at that. نون صاد حا كاف يا ميم قاف ألف طاء عين لام ها سين and را. Those are the 14 letters which we will find in the beginning of the surahs which begin with those letters.
And the companion didn't ask about the meaning.
Exactly. And that's why we're supposed to pause at 12. These letters, with regards to Madd now, deviating from tafsir and the meaning of those letters, with regards to how long should we lengthen those letters, undergo three categories, three cases. The first one is regarding the letters which will not be prolonged or lengthened at all. And that's only one letter out of 14, leaving behind how many?
13.
This letter is the Alif. Why is that? Let's look at the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah. It begins by Muhammad.
Alif, Lam, Mim.
Right? Even though the Mad was not enough, but we'll just let you pass.
Okay.
Alif. You said, Lam. And you prolonged or lengthened the Mim as well. Six counts. But when you said Alif, you said Alif. Was there any Mad, Mustafa?
No.
Obviously not. that is the only of the 14 letters which we may find in the beginning of some surahs which we do not lengthen. Why is that? Surah Al-Baqarah, Alif Lam Mim, Surah Yunus, Alif Lam Ra. So if we were to pronounce it properly, we would say Alif Lam Ra. So the Alif is not to be lengthened the least. Why is that? Because this letter, when we spell it out, its spelling is Alif, Lam, and Fa. Remember?
Yeah.
Alif, Lam, and Fa. Is there any mad letter in the middle?
No.
Is there any non-vowel? Is there any sakin letter in the middle?
No.
No. So basically, since there is no mad letter, we're not allowed to lengthen the Alif the least. The second case is the letters which should be lengthened مد طبيعي, natural مد. I'll take you back a few months ago when we spoke about المد الطبيعي, then we spoke about certain letters put together in one phrase. Some of the chapters of the Quran may begin with these letters are حي طهر. How many letters in this phrase?
Five.
Okay. The حاء, the ياء, the طاء, the هاء, and the راء. So we had the alif before. And we have here five. That is total?
Six.
Out of 14?
Nine.
Yeah. Out of 14?
Eight.
Okay. So the five letters of this second case, whenever we see them in the beginning of the surahs, we'll give them only mad tabi'i. يعني إيه mad tabi'i? What does it mean? Natural mad, only two counts. Only two counts. Why? Because the mad letter in each one of these letters, we say it spills into letters. The mad letter into these letters are not being followed by an original sukoon after the mad letter. And this original sukoon is the reason behind prolonging or lengthening the mad letter into six counts as a mad lazim, meaning the word Taha, which we begin Surah Taha with. Taha, Taha, Ta. It spells as Ta'an Alif. And this Alif will be lengthened only two counts. Mad Tabi'i, so say Taha, Taha, Bas. And the letters حاميم. The ميم is a mad lazim. But حا only two counts. Okay. The third case. So in the case of المد الطبيعي, it will be applicable with five letters. Those five letters will put into
حي طهر.
حي into one phrase, which is حي طهر. The حا, the ياء, the طاء, the ها, and the را. Okay. The third case is our subject, which is المد اللازم. المد اللازم. Letters should be lengthened for six counts as a must. The number of these letters is
eight.
Combined in the Arabic phrases, as I said, that scholars phrase them differently. Some like to say, كم عسل نقص? And some say, نقص عسلكم. أو سنقص علمك. Either way, what really concerns us is that there are eight letters. So the scholars of Tajweed combine them in a phrase in order to facilitate and make it easy for the students of the Qira'at to memorize them.
Yeah.
Especially in the case of Al-Matn, or the poetry of the Tajweed. Sin, Noon, Qaf, Sad, Ayn, Lam, Mim, Kaf. All those letters will be lengthened as a must six counts whenever we see them in the beginning of the surahs, except one letter. This letter is the Ayn. This letter can be either lengthened optionally two, four, or six counts. Why is that? Why is it exempt from the rest of the eight letters? We'll learn this right now, inshallah. But we have to look at the spelling of the letter Ayn. You know, if somebody just joined the program right now and heard me saying that, let's spell the letter Ayn, it doesn't make any sense. How would you spell a letter?
Yeah.
Right? But I say, write the letter as you say it. Write down the letter as you say it, as you utter it. So when I say, Ayn, yeah, Ayn is a letter. You can write the Ayn. But spell it out. A, yeah,
noon.
Ayn, okay. We wrote it down. Look at the screen. Look at the spelling of the letter Ayn and the vowels on each the vowel on each letter. The first letter has fatha.
Fatha.
And the second letter is a ya.
Emphasized.
It's a non-vowel ya. It has a sukun, right? Yeah. The ya is one of the mad letters. But only if it is a sakina and preceded by the kasra.
Yeah.
But in this case, it is sakina. Preceded it's not preceded by kasra. Yeah. It's preceded by a letter that has
fatha.
Fatha. So that converts into a lean letter, and we studied before mad lean in the case of the waw and the ya, which will be preceded by a letter that has fatha.
Yeah.
So in this case, we will deal with it as a lean letter, not as a mad letter. As a lean letter, not as a mad letter. And accordingly, we retreat back and we go to the classroom. We studied the rules of mad lean. We said it is permissible to lengthen it 2, 4, or 6. Then the scholars would have some detailed explanations with regards to if you are a person, a reciter of the Quran, who decided to shorten al-mad al-munfasil, the separate mad, to make it only 2, then you should choose the 2 in the case of da'ain, mad al-leen. But if he decided to make it long, then as well al-ishba' here, or making it 6 counts is superior. Well, let's practice some examples in order to comprehend the meaning of what was just said. The letter kaf, in the beginning of Surah
Maryam.
It's full of letters. We have the kaf, we have the ha, we have the ya, we have the ayn, we have the sa. Okay. Can you, Muhammad, give me point to the letters which would only prolong them or lengthen them? Mad tabi'i, only 2 counts?
I think the first one.
The ha
think
and
about
the
it. Remember the phrase hayun tahur. So yeah. The kaf is not there. The first one is not there. But the ha hayun tahur, the ha is there. And the ya and the ya is there. So initially we excluded 2 letters. We said that we will lengthen them only
2 harakas.
2 counts. We'll say ha and ya. And guess what? The ayn. We said it's exempt from the previous rule. So we will lengthen it either 2, 4, or 6. And since we choose to lengthen al-mad al-munfasil, the separate mad, then we will apply the ishba' and the ayn will prolong it or lengthen it 6 counts as well. But not as a mad lazim. Not as a mad lazim. Rather as mad lean. We were given the option to do it 2, 4, or 6. Muhammad. I want to hear it from you, given 6 counts, 6 harakat to the kaf, 2 to the ha, 2 to the ya, 6 to the ayn, then 6 to the sad. And remember, between the ayn and the sad, there is ikhfa. And the ghunna would be deep because of the tafkhim of the letter sad, which is one of the letters of al-istihla. Let's listen to it from you first.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim.
Take a deep breath.
كاف ها يا عين صاد
ما شاء الله very close بارك الله فيك شندي
كاف ها يا عين صاد
what Shindy did is the calf was only 5. The ha and the ya is 2, this is very obvious. And the ayn, he made it 2. And we said we decided to do it
6.
Then the ikhba, then the sad, 6. Mustafa. Ready?
Kaf ha ayn
كاف ها يا عين صاد.
ما شاء الله, very close. Now listen to me and we'll practice it. Then inshallah, after this break, we'll continue practicing. Hopefully, inshallah, we'll resume with the same ahkam in the next episode. Okay. So we'll say, as I said, take a deep breath because you will need it. You need six for the kaf. Ha, two. Ya, two. Ayn, six. Then two for the gunna of the ikhfa. And another six for, I want you to add them up and let me know how many by the end. So we'll say, كاف ها يا عين صاد. Okay, one more time. That's a special request from the director. Okay, كاف ها يا صاد. Six, two,
ten.
Six, then two for the غنى أو الإخفاء, and another
six.
A short break, and إن شاء الله we should return back very soon. Please stay tuned.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Anyone who chooses other than Islam as a religion, as a way, it won't be accepted from him. This Quran has to be understood by the way the companions of Rasulullah understood the Quran. We disconnect ourselves from the actions of certain Muslims who oppress people and kill people unjustly.
Recite it every day and do read it loud.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh and welcome back. Let me remind you with our phone numbers 002, area code 02-3855-248 or 249. I wanted to begin reading together, but we have some callers on the line, so we'll begin with the first caller today. Please go ahead and recite from verse number 77 of Surah Al-Kahf, which begins by فَانْطَلَقَ Brother Abu Ali out of Egypt.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh and welcome to the program.
How are you doing, Sheikh Muhammad?
Alhamdulillah. Thank you so much for asking.
May Allah, Allah bless you and your efforts for da'wah, inshallah.
Jazakumullah khayr.
Wa alaikum inshallah.
Verse 77. Verse 77, inshallah.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. فَانْطَلَقَا حَتَّى إِذَا أَتَيَا أَهْلَ قَرْيَةٍ اسْتَطْعَمَا أَهْلَهَا فَأَبَوْا أَنْ يُضَيِّفُوهُمَا فَوَجَدَا فِيهَا جِدَارًا يُرِيدُ أَنْ يَنْقَضَّ فَأَقَامَهُ.
Okay, would you go back and recite the word, read the word jidara once again and make sure it is dal, not ضال. Thank you, Muhammad.
فوجد فيها جدارا يريد أن ينقض فأقام.
فوجد فيها جدا دا not ضا. Okay, listen to both of them. فوجد فيها جدارا يريد أن ينقض فأقام versus جدارا. It is not ضاد. Rather, it is ذال. Okay.
فوجد فيها جدارا يريد أن ينقض فأقام. قال لو شئت لاتخذت عليه أجرا. قال هذا فراق بيني وبينك سأنبئك بتأويل ما لم تستطع عليه صبرا.
I want to pause with this ayah for a little bit, Abu Ali. Look at this. The word سأنبي. There is a very obvious كسرة beneath the ba. Okay. Mistakenly, some of us would say سأنبؤك أو سأنبؤك. Why? Because preparing yourself to pronounce the ضمة or the pesh on top of the kaf.
Yeah.
So make sure it is كسرة beneath the ba. سأنبؤك. Also with the word تستطيع. تستطيع. We should never confuse the تاء with the
طاء.
The تاء is totally different letter, and that's why we have it as a letter in the Arabic alphabet. So it is تستطيع, not تستطيع.
Okay. قال هذا فراق بيني وبينك سأنبئك بتأويل ما لم تستطع عليه صبرا.
ما شاء الله.
أما السفينة فكانت لمساكين يعملون في البحر فأردت أن أعيبها وكان وراءهم ملك يأخذ كل سفينة غصبا.
جزاك الله خيرا. Thank you so much. We have another caller, Abu Jihad, with us on the phone. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaikum assalam wa barakatuh. How are you?
Alhamdulillah wa shukrullah. Please proceed from the next verse. That is verse number 80. وأما الغلام.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. وأما الغلام فكان أبواه مؤمنين فخشينا أن يرهقهما طغيانا وكفرا.
Waku. Make sure the kaf is much softer than the qaf. So it is wakufra.
Wakufra.
Naam.
فَأَرَدْنَا أَنْ يُبْدِلَهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا خَيْرًا أَنْ يُبْدِلَهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا خَيْرًا مِنْهُ زَكَاةً وَأَقْرَبَ رُحْمًا. وأما الجدار فكان لغلامين يتيمين في المدينة وكان تحته كنز لهما وكان أبوهما صالحا فأراد ربك أن يبلغ أشدهما ويستخرج كنزهما رحمة من ربك.
It would be better if you say ويستخرج كنزهما رحمة من ربك.
ويستخرج كنزهما رحمة من ربك وما فعلته عن أمري. ذلك تأويل ما لم تستطع عليه صبرا. ويسألونك عن ذي القرنين قل سأتلو عليكم منه ذكرا.
جزاك الله خيرا. Remember the kaf is not one of the qalqalah letters, so it is ذكرا. ذكرى ذكرى. جزاك الله خيرا أبو جهاد. Thank you so much. I think we have somebody else on the phone. السلام عليكم. Okay, كرف. جزاكم الله خيرا. محمد شندي. The last caller recited from verse number 80. I want you to recite it again, then we'll elaborate on some of the common mistakes which we may do as beginners. Verse number 80 once again.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. وأما الغلام فكان أبواه مؤمنين فخشينا أن يرهقهما طغيانا وكفرا فأردنا أن يبدلهما ربهما خيرا منه زكاة وأقرب رحما.
Beautiful, ما شاء الله. So two things. He said, فأردنا, right? Because it's a dal. And it is not befitting to say, فأردنا. Then he converted it into ضاد. And it would change the meaning completely. فأردنا, that we want it, or we willed. But فأردنا, it has no meaning. Also he said, أن يبدلهما ربهما خيرا منه زكاة وأقرب رحما, not رحما. Okay, that's a common mistake. Next verse, and we only have 1 minute to the end of the program.
وَأَمَّا الْجِدَارُ فَكَانَ لِغُلَامَيْنِ يَتِيمَيْنِ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ وَكَانَ تَحْتَهُ كَنْزٌ لَهُمَا وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا فأراد ربك أن يبلغا أشدهما ويستخرجا كنزهما.
Make sure the خاء is one of the تفخيم letters, حرف من حروف الاستعلاء. ويستخرجا. Meanwhile, the تاء is soft.
ويستخرجا كنزهما رحمة من ربك وما فعلته عن أمري. ذلك تأويل ما لم تستع عليه صبرا.
بارك
تستع
الله.
عليه صبرا.
جزاكم الله خيرا. Thank you so much. Unfortunately, we ran out of time. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the end of this episode to bless us all and to accept this humble effort from all of us. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Brothers and sisters, to increase your iman, read the miracle, recite the Quran, recite it every day and do read it loud. The verses of Quran are all Muslims' pride. This miracle was revealed over a long time span, sent from Allah to an angel, then to a man. That man was Muhammad, the best of creation. We were chosen to be part of his nation. He gave us a message, and that was Islam. So read this miracle, recite the Quran.